I don't know what happened. I restarted the client again at 64-bit, and it seems to be okay this time around. Anyways, yeah, so we're just going to go for a quick introduction for those that are either just tuning in, or obviously we'll start the VOD here. We are looking at the Star Ladder Chinese best of two match between FTD Club B and the Wings Gaming. So this is game number one of the best of two series. Did miss a little bit, but just for looking at the sides, we're actually going to see a smoke gank that Hitagi missed out on, unfortunately, but it might just be fine enough to go for the Night Stalker Queen of Pain duo into the enemy jungle. Anyways, they're invading here. They've got an Invis rune on the Juggernaut. They have James on this Night Stalker. Now they've reverted all to Chinese characters when a few of these were not. Oh, that's frustrating. But we're just going to watch the gank happen. X here is going to be maybe leading the charge here on the Slardar. If he gets a crush opener, they have definitely got one kill, maybe two. And, of course, we get some perfect world lag on top. This is just going to be a hell of a night, I can tell, guys. Anyways, it looks like their smoke has failed. It's just too reserved a position for the Wraith King, who, of course, can skill reincarnate at a moment's notice. And they can get some TPs to turn things around. So we're going to be looking over at a more reserved position during the night. They've only got 1 minute left on the clock before it turns daytime, and they really haven't taken advantage of it at all. I'm really struggling with the tech. This lag is not from your stream. It is definitely Dota TV, aka Perfect World. And we are going to be seeing Bang go down to a Blade Fury. Nice little void opener there. They just catch him out, straight up. No Surge to save him, as the Darkseer has already made his way over to the mid. There's going to be Shadow Fiend. He's going to be under pressure here from the Queen of Pain. Has that 2-1-3-1 build up, and looks to do some good damage. But Bane's here already, getting the Nightmare out onto the Queen of Pain. Could be very problematic for her, but the Raze misses. And now she's going to blink out and get a very nice Sonic Wave onto Ice to Bane. So, they do pop the wall, no vacuum. And it's just going to be trading those two ulties, the wall and the Sonic Wave. But I would say overall Wings are worse for wear in terms of health pools, and they're going to be kind of hiding under tower. I hate to do this to you guys, but I'm going to try one last thing and hopefully fix Perfect World, because, you know, we got a long night ahead.
Haste.
I figure we already missed a little bit of the game. What's 30 more seconds to try to get you guys a lag-free broadcast here? Otherwise, you'll be looking at picking up the Star Ladder ticket and trying your luck with the Dota TV connection from your end. Switching back over. Hopefully it has helped out a little bit. We'll see. Crazy things going on with the Bane, but that might just be his attack animation. Nope, no it is not. This is going to be a long night. This is a hard game. But we'll see what we can do. Right now we've got Ancient Apparition encroaching on level 6. They're obviously looking for the kill here. Level 3 Cold Feet. They certainly know the synergy between the Wraith Fire Blast and the Cold Feet, as they're prioritizing those spells above all else. You get that Icy Vortex down, and I think even with a sprint away, you should be able to get the Cold Feet to connect. Kale. Alright, so we have got Hitagi, mostly leeching mid here. He's going for the solo experience while we do see the Queen of Pain clearing out stacks and just in general jungling. So this will get the earlier Winter's Curse out on the Wyvern as compared to like the Fiend's Grip on the Bane, the Ice Blast on the AA. But whether or not they'll be able to really take advantage of that timing window, it really comes down to their next smoke movement, which I'm sure they're preparing for. We're going to be seeing the Juggernaut here just go for the Battle Fury, and he's going to be looking for that to build himself up. It's pretty good against Darkseer in general. The Wall of Replica Illusions, you don't want those to be breaking your Omni Slashes. Nice combo here. Wraith Fire Blast, Cold Feet, and despite the crush, he is going to be Cold Feeted for a very, very long time. The last hit delivered. That is actually a 2.75 second stun, and like I said, very difficult for Slaughter to get away from. Maybe if you max sprint you can, but certainly not without. We're going to see Queen of Pain jump in onto the Bane. They've committed the Winter's Curse. And despite the Ice Blast coming back through, they are able to find themselves a nice little pick off there. putting a dent here in the tier 1 tower. Should be able to bring it down, no problem. But there's going to be Wraith King. At 3 TPs, everybody's trying to defend this, and it looks like they will hold it for now. They did take the top tier 1. They get the luxury of rotating to defend their mid, and there we'll leave them to it. Pretty deep Observer ward here. Really good coverage from the Radiant overall, and not ones that you'd normally deward. Like, you usually see, like, the Sentry placed out here to block out any wards south of that line, and obviously, like, Sentry wards over here or up on the cliff. But these wards here, it's just outside the spawn box. It's not going to be blocking it, but it gives them good intel into the Shadow Fiend's farming routes for the most part. Alrighty. So, nighttime it is. It's going to be that 11:20 darkness, and then they're going to obviously get the 12-minute night back-to-back with that. So, Night Stalker roaming around, has the Tranquil Boots very fast, with just 1 point hunt of the night, and they should be able to find themselves at least a kill at night. That's their game plan anyways. So, we got minor net worth advantage, mostly the experience swinging forward for FTD, as they do have a 2-kill lead, and they've been spreading the map. Like I said, Queen of Vayne's been in the jungle quite a bit. But unfortunately, no matter how good these wards are, we're actually seeing that it's going to be a no intel given to them in terms of a gank path. Normally, you'd see somebody farming there, you get a quick, easy kill thanks to your vision. Instead, they're going to say, well, there's nobody there. Let's go to a new location. And they're going to break their smoke here on the ancient apparition, look for the tower dive, and that should be a very quick kill. Omni Slash committed to secure it. But that's going to be a tier 1 tower pressured top. Queen of Pain in Viz, maybe looking for a turnaround play down bottom, or even in the mid. There is no Dire Observer Ward for the high ground, so really a blind Shadow Fiend right now is going to get caught by that Shadow Strike, but without any reinforcement. Going to be that tier 1 going down easy. I don't think they're going to mass TP for this one again. They do have the glyph, but they really just want to start controlling the enemy's territory and start taking better advantage over the map. So this tower, not really of consequence in that regard, and that means that they're just going to let it go. Go ahead and just put a lot of damage here into the tier 1 bottom. Wraith King opens with the Blade Mail, means that he has to be very far on the front lines. You have to be really involved with the Blade Mail if you're going to make that item work. It's not a bad item, because essentially, with your ultimate, you have two free health bars, and a good chance you'll get that second Blade Mail off. But you really want to make sure that you get caught inside the Sonic Wave intentionally to reflected on the Queen of Pain, and just in general, be as aggressive as possible to tank up that damage for your team. Beyond that, he'll definitely go for Radiance next. I can't really imagine much else. Like I said, there's those Blink BKB armlet builds, and those are fine. SMY is not bad, but I think here he just wants the Radiance to really start making an impact. We're going to see the Fiend's Grip go onto James here. Ice Blast goes across. Easy pickings for the Shadow Fiend, who now is able to just absolutely destroy this tower. I find it quite interesting they actually skilled up the Necromastery to level 3 and then went for 1 point in the presence of the Dark Lord. This only affects units, not towers, but it's still a good amount of negative armor for their enhancing their physical damage output. Oh, Deny coming in, possibly here. No, it's going to go to the Radiant as the Card of the Catapult Dyer's secures that tower kill. Looks like Beyond wants to fight here. There's going to be a crush against him. The Mechanism counteracts it, and now the Winter's Curse. Oh, a big Winter's Curse from Hitagi. With the Sonic Wave Scream, they'll definitely clean up one. It looks like the Shadow Fiend, no, is able to turn around, throw out some raises, and just kill off the Slardar. Man, they keep him alive just in the nick of time. I think that was a max magic wand to save him. And now they'll just earn him back up to full. Wraith King comes in the side. Queen of Pain's got the blink out, though. Oh, Cold Embraced. No, the blink wasn't there. Another... obviously the lag bug, I'm doing my best here, guys, but they go ahead and just drop the wall right on top of her when she gets the Cold Embrace, and that does work out for a nice little kill there. Anyways, we've got the Roshan going down here. This is a very nice play from Wings, because you better believe that FDD were looking to pick this up within the next 5 minutes. They could easily kill off the tier 1, get a D ward over here, get maybe an obs up here, and then just go in with the Slardar and the Juggernaut. The negative armor and just the healing ward allows them to do that very nicely. Instead, they're going to be doing a lot of damage to it, but it's not going to be so easy. They're going to have to fight for it here. Lots of damage going into the Night Stalker. He's barely going to get out here, but with no urn charges bringing stuff back up, he's going to be kind of staying on the outskirts of the fight. They won't connect with the Splinter Blast, and that means the Wraith King is going to be sitting here with his both lives available. The smoke, however, it kind of failed to allow them to go for a fake back. And now they're going to have to wrap around. They're so cut off right now as Beyond is over to the west, and they're going to have to charge in and commit all four heroes for this fight. We're going to actually see the Wraith King drop down very early. The Reincarnate going to be doing some good slowing action, but in the meantime, that amp damage on the Roshan is going to be bringing it very low. Bane here just trying to survive with the Brain Sap and the Nightmare wreaks havoc. The Dire will get the kill, and Shadowfiend will get the Aegis, but now the Winter's Curse comes through and kills them all. Ice Blast going to be coming through in just a moment. Will it be enough? Yes, he'll kill off one. He'll kill off the Slardar, but we'll keep our eye on the Night Stalker here, as I think he's all right. Yeah. Just narrowly, but he will survive. And that's going to be them walking away happy. Yeah, they did lose the Roshan. They clean up the Aegis immediately, though, and FTD are just doing so much work with this Wyvern in particular. This was like their first pick on the Wyvern, but we're still seeing Wings caught in a lot of situations where they're just clumping really hard, and this allows the Winter Wyvern just to do so much work in these kinds of engagements. They're really using this cooldown well. And, of course, you follow that up with a Sonic Wave about right when the Winter's Curse ends so that they can't be mitigated. It's just a really good combo. We're seeing a lot of great team fight plays coming out from FTDB. And now suddenly an Aghanim Scepter in just 800 gold for the Queen of Pain. Alrighty, so this will delay the Wraith King's next item, whatever Shadow may look to pick up. Shadow, who happens to be sponsored by Big Dick, his words, not mine. Yeah, he's gonna get caught by the Ice Blast here. Juggernaut will be Fiend's Gripped when he's trying to spin away, so he's gonna be eating the Vacuum back, and that will give them the Wraith Fire Blast. The Shatter debuff will expire, but they drop the wall, and that's gonna be enough damage to bring him down. I think he crit himself there, actually. In the meantime, Shadowfiend's just farming himself up with this nice little Dominator pickup. Allows you to be pretty much full HP when going on the jungle, and could do some stacking action or just maybe possess an enemy catapult. The wolf isn't bad either, I would suppose. The alpha wolf, this one in particular right here, that's being slaughtered by the Night Stalker, could be pretty valuable to dominate. Anywho. We're going to be seeing Wings kind of just playing defensively for the time being. They have taken a pretty heavy beating in the last few fights, and we see a massive net worth advantage right now for the Queen of Pain and the Juggernaut. That translates into an Aghanim Scepter here and just 200 gold, but a quick pick will give him it for free, as the Wyvern is actually going to be the one to get the last hit there. No Winter's Curse required. So a nice little opening onto the Shadow Fiend. And Slaughter has the Blink Crush here onto the Ancient Apparition, but he doesn't want to go for it. He definitely had the range, but maybe you guessed wrong in the fog. Now you're without a stun against maybe four heroes, and you're just a little bit too worried about it. No. Being sponsored by Big Dicks is not as glamorous as people would imagine. It's not the same implication that I think he was going for, at least not in the West.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
But this net worth graph is pretty rickety-rockety here. Not even 1,000 net worth leading for FTD. Just everything going back and forth here. And obviously the Roshan does count as kind of like a killer too. Shadowfiend going to be caught out here. Does have a decent amount of armor with the Dominator, but it looks like he's still going down as they commit the ultimate to him. Actually, what? He's getting bottled up, and he's not going to be going down. That is unfortunate. They just didn't commit enough. The Sonic Wave came out really late there. They did not... Sonic Wave, I believe, on the Shadow Fiend, unless Reborn missed it. Or not, I can't even blame Reborn, it's the Perfect World server. But either way, as far as I could tell, there was no Sonic Wave. They undercommitted for the Shadow Fiend, and it cost them, as the rotation brings down the Winter Wyvern here. Alrighty, so we've got Juggernaut getting the solo push here on the Tier 1 tower. That should be no problem at all for them to take down. But we do have Ice looking for maybe an opportunity to punish it. The Fiend's Grip will come out at a range, but who's TPing in? There is going to be a Blade Fury, but he still gets hit by the Ice Blast, and one stun should do him in here. They get the stun on the Juggernaut, and one more hit will bring him down. Tower now just outside deny range. In the meantime, Shadowfiend gets picked off again. Shadowfiend, why are you farming out this far when your enemies are setting something up bottom? That really becomes a question. As this is like the fourth death for this hero? Yeah, 1-4-1. On this SF, really having a rough game, and having to go for a full defensive build. Tred's wand dominator into Sanj is really not the build you want. I mean, you can farm quickly with your spells, but even still, it just makes it very difficult to gain momentum this game. As you can see, he's down here 5th on net worth when he should be in the top 2. Yep, there's absolutely nothing I can do about the lag right now, guys. It is not your stream. Everything's going through, no frames dropping here, but my connectivity through the Great Firewall of China seems to be not playing well, at least for this game. I'll try to see what I can do for the next one, and in the meantime, we'll make do with some, you know, give or take teamfight commentary. So we got the Blink initiation on Darkseer. This is actually pretty huge if they can catch somebody off guard. Blink Vacuum is not as easy to follow up with their current lineup. They don't have any like major AoE stuns. But just charging in there, they're going to be able to pull them back, get the Nightmare onto the Queen of Pain, followed up with that Wraithfire Blast, and that's going to be a very quick death of the Queen of Pain. However, she will get her Sonic Wave out in the process, doing a lot of damage, killing off the Bane, and nearly forcing the Wraith King to lose his first life. He'll throw out a stun here. They'll keep trying to fight around the wall while Juggernaut just goes right in and Omni slashes him down. The Reincarnate will now take effect, but here's going to be a big Blink Crush if they can only get past the wall. But they're going to have to sprint around, and at that point, it's really not worth it to go on anybody that's available. The Wraith King actually gets a pre-cast at Wraithfire Blaster, comboing up on the Slaughter. Slaughter goes down! Really nice Wraithfire Blast from Shadow as he saw him and was able to bring him down before he really made a move. Now we do see James just fleeing back. Wraith King still with no Reincarnate. They really want to punish this by going in, but the damage looks like it's not enough. Oh, it will be enough to break down the Wraith King. And now the Requiem. It's not really zoning them the way they want it to. As Slaughter jumps in, he TP'd to the tier 2 tower, blinks forward, gets the crush, but Innocence finding himself a nice little TP back, or Y. I don't know. This is tough, guys. This is really a challenge, but I'll continue to try to do my best under these circumstances. Yeah, the Wraith King just going a little bit too far forward. It looked like he almost would survive there, but didn't get a chance to use his wand before it went down. Very close call. And obviously the Slardar buyback was a huge part of that. He did buy back, but he got enough in return, getting the Wraith King actual kill, and then of course the Shadow Fiend. Ice Ice down to the Sonic Wave, 40 second cooldown, no problem at all. But this is going to be an interesting TP here. Darkseer might be tanky, but yeah, he's going to cancel it up as well. It's so easy to get stunned up by the Slaughter in that situation, and one unlucky bash will be your undoing. Juggernaut farming down bottom, but no Fiend Script to really lock him down. He has the mana for Spin. Gonna vacuum him back, trying to get that Wraithfire Blast out, but no Spin, and walk away. No Ice Blast to connect. So they will be putting a lot of damage in this tier 2 tower, but kind of in the central area that they're kind of fighting. They're ready to fight on either lane. It looks like we're going to be looking at this mid-engagement, though, as the Glyph has popped, and that tower is in deny range. They don't want to let this tower go, but at the same time, it's not really easy to force this with the Ice Blast cooling down. So in the end, it looks like FTD are just going to be pulling back here, unless Hidagi goes for a really cool smoke play here. Dire, don't see anything at the moment. And they're just going to go, it looks like, for the safe deny. Assuming they want to. Like, sometimes you want that tower to stay up for a little bit longer. Obviously, the proxy TP to the Roche Pit is really important. Another big factor is the just the fact that the gold is still on the table for right now. If you can just hang on to it for as long as possible, and then right when they're about to take it, get the deny out there, that's far preferable than just handing it to them outright. We're actually going to see that smoke come out, though. They did go back. They're going to find the Wraith King, though. Not the target they wanted, as he's going to pop the Blade Mail before the Crush even comes out. And then he obviously has his ultimate available. So, really, if they found any other target, that would be a kill, and that would be the tower. Instead, it's going to be denied here by the Shadow Fiend here at the last moment. So, nice movement there from Shadow, just kind of scouting out their next play. They knew the Wyvern was carrying around a smoke, so they kind of had to expect that kind of move. Didn't really get a chance to talk about item progression, but here, James is doing really well for himself. Despite being a support, not Nightstalker roaming around, he's found himself 2-3-6. Obviously, they've gotten some tower momentum, and he's gotten himself a Midas, which is quickly turning into half an eggs. So, we'll see that maybe 30-minute eggs timing, which is not far from the average. The Fiend's Grip play again for the Juggernaut, but this time not only does he spin, but he's got backup, and we're going to see maybe a really good Winter's Curse. First, a two-man crush. There's a Sonic Wave as well. That's an amazing Winter's Curse, really locking down Wings on the backside. But they're still pretty tanky, all of them. Holding for now. The Omni Slash was pretty wasted on creeps. Didn't really get to see much from that. And although another crush comes through, it's going to be James on the back line that looks to assassinate the Shadow Fiend. He's surviving just narrowly and actually turns it around with a nice double raise. Queen of Pain blinking right on top of him and bringing him low. Going to be Juggernaut trying to TP away from this while Wraith King comes back kicking. Is going to look for at least one kill out of all this, but it's so hard to pursue. He's so sluggish, and in fact, it's going to be him that's now under a bit of fire. He takes some hits, nice little blade mail, and Ice Blast really going to be hurting Queen of Pain. If, say there was dot ticks on this Wraith King and he blade mailed it, that would actually be her death. And so it's going to be an awkward little Slardar crush before he jumps out. He's X is kind of playing with them right now, and, you know, you're playing with fire in those situations. Ah, kind of a crazy little team fight, especially with the lag, but you'll see here, we got a lot of damage coming out of the Wraith King. 4 Wraith Fire Blasts coming out of this guy with his 2 lives. And, of course, a lot from the Ancient Empress 2, those heroes surviving for the longest period of time. But in the end, FTD, they lose some time on nighttime, but overall they garner the most. And that's because of the bait play they had, where essentially they pretended the Juggernaut was the only man there, and they had everybody else waiting all around here. Guardian Greaves up for the Darkseer, not too shabby. 4 Staff, finally finished for Ancient Apparition. But what is the Bane looking for here? Just a Medallion. Could go for the Solar Crest long term, but overall, surely not getting much as he's playing the full 5 position, and you can see him there at 2750 on net worth. Ice has played on some really good teams. Oh, okay. Vacuum for the Juggernaut. What are they going to do about that? He's just going to spin TP. Screw you guys, I'm going home. But yeah, so what we're looking at here is, yeah, I was going to talk about a little bit about the history of Ice Ice. He actually played on Team Big God for a long, long time there, and he got a lot of props for that. He was able to excel in a lot of ways, and the team had their ups and downs, but overall he seemed to be a pretty core contributor to their success. And glad to see that he's still involved in the scene, albeit on a little bit of an underrated team. These guys are definitely the underdogs in some of the harder matchups, but they've shown that they can do a lot of work. That being said, FTD have been playing this game 1 very nicely. And with the BKB on the Queen of Pain, the AG's about to finish on this Nightstalker. Not as close as I thought, actually. For some reason, I thought he had another component. He's still 1,000 gold off, unfortunately. But alas, they will start taking control of the night in a little bit here. And of course, in the meantime, the Juggernaut will just keep farming. He's got that Battle Fury, so he can break down the creep waves and the illusions pretty easily with his Omni Slash. And most importantly, just farms really quickly via Battle Fury. Split pushes with the Manta. And his intention is that he'll be able to Manta dodge the Wraith Fire Blast, maybe use a Invulnerability Frame to kind of dodge a Bane spell. Obviously, you can't dodge the spells, they're non-projectile, but you can really mess up the targeting. Radiance. Looking over at Dire's vision, they do see a decent bit with this ward. It's not great for the Dire side, but they might have at least have an inkling that there was some activity going on in the pit here. So the next Ice Blast should be going that direction, but the Wild Wing will actually make its way Radiance there first and scout it out. Ice Vortex too. So in the end, Roshan's just going to be doing hanging out solo in the pit. Nobody taking advantage of that for the time being, but Juggernaut sees a little Wild Wing to bring down. Kills off the Ripper with a nice crit, and he's now picked up a fresh Blink Dagger, so really ready to assault the backline, kill off the Bane or the AA very early in the fight. Could be quite promising. Sometimes you even see Abyssal Blade after this. Like, you go Blink Abyssal, and then you can just pin down the SF, BKB or not. Could be very powerful. So, we've got Darkseer pretty farmed up, gonna look for the Shiva's Guard next, it looks like, and we'll see from there, but I'm assuming the Wyvern will just commit his goal to a Gem of Truth site soon. No, he's actually building up a real item here. He's looking for the 4-staff with Seam. Yule's isn't bad, But I think he's going for the Force Staff. Either way, that means the Night Stalker might have to buy the gem himself as he's completed his Aghanim Scepter here at this moment. Little skirmish here for a tier 1 tower that still happens to be standing, but now we're going to see a quick kill on the courier, a nice little crush, and then Juggernaut will be Fiend's Grip, but again getting the spin out at the perfect time. Man, this guy's good at spinning. Now we're going to see him jump through the backline. There are creeps involved here, but he's cleaving on those as well. So he is going to do some good damage with that Omni Slash, and they're going to clean up the Wraith King once, presumably. They first focus down the Bane, and Shadow is still kicking here, though dropping very, very low on the high ground. We're going to see a nice little Blink Crush here. Wraith King should be going down for the first time here, but he's got that 60-second Reincarnate, and FTD want none of that. They've lost the Wyvern, they've lost the Night Stalker, and Shadow will stand. I think, really, in my mind, you have to really make a choice whether you're going to ignore the Wraith King or focus him down. There's no point in bringing half-assing it and bringing this guy to, like, a third HP or only killing him once. You really got to make a decision to kill him outright or just ignore him completely. I feel like the supports are so much better to focus down. The Shadow Fiend doesn't have a BKB. He can be annihilated with the Slaughter just sticking on top of him. But, so far, it's been pretty stretched out. They chase down the Bane over into the river over here, and while it's a nice little kill, they end up losing on that exchange. Now it's going to be Wings' turn to regroup. Do they have a smoke here? Yes, Ice Ice, picking it up. They don't have a courier, but they do have the smoke, and it looks like they're going to go for that play right now, which could be... Oh no, the amp damage. Oh, that sucks. They definitely would have, if not for that amp. But now they don't want to be conspicuous. They're just going to make normal rotations. And that Wyvern ulti is going to get the chance to cool down as a result. Gem of True Sight. Diffusal Blade coming out for the Juggernaut. Very interesting. I don't think that's going to do enough. If Wraith King sees it, he's going to just not cast that last Wraithfire Blast and make sure that he has about 300 mana instead of the 160. As long as you keep a decent threshold of mana, I don't think Purge is going to be enough, even with the Manta style, but we'll see. He'll try for it, and we're just going to see some good damage coming in. They're going to assault the backline, but the Fiend's Grip will come through. Nice back wall as well, and the Juggernaut doesn't even get the Omni Slash off. The Wyvern can't do anything to help him out. Hidagi flies off into the sunset, but it doesn't look like it's going to be a happy ending for him. He'll be knocked out despite the Golden Brace, and that's going to be a 2-0. Yeah, the Manta, right now, Diffusal does a mana burn of 25 per hit. He obviously hits the Manta style, and Juggernaut has a very low base attack time. I believe it's 1.4. So all these things lead to him attacking really quickly and burning a lot of mana, but you're still going to be probably burning about, I don't know, 100 mana a second? It's not enough if Wraith King just only stuns once. At least that's my mindset towards it. The do-it-yourself anti-mage here, I don't feel like it's the build. If there was something to purge on top of that and it was like dual valued, then I would love the pickup, but just for mana burn, I feel like it's a little bit weak. Obviously Ghost Scepter might come into play a little bit later here, and if that's the case, then great, you have something to purge. But right now you're seeing a Bane that is as poor as can be, and a Ancient Apparition who really wants to prioritize the Aghanim Scepter himself. So with that all in mind, you're really not looking to purge a ghost anytime soon. Maybe Bane saves for it now and starts shifting ward duty to somebody else. We're actually going to see a two-man smoke here. This is a bit curious. I'm not exactly sure what they expect to accomplish just with Fiend's Grip, but I assume that they expect the Juggernaut just to be farming a little bit too aggressively. They can punish it, but right now it's mostly looking just a Slaughter who can blink and force staff away. He's going to see it just in time, blinks out, and that is not going to be a successful kill. Just finding the wrong target, wrong place, wrong time, unfortunately. Alrighty, so the Gem of True Sight, purchased by the Night Stalker himself. James has invested his full inventory for map dominance. Oh gosh, Juggernaut, what are you doing, man? This is not where you want to be. He mantas, he spins, but he just can't get away. And he finds himself caught out once again. That's actually the Shadow Blade that catches him off guard here. So, it's actually the Shadow Fiend going invis underneath the Juggernaut, popping that big Requiem, and you'll see that he did a lot of damage. That scared off the Juggernaut. He'll try as he might to get away. He only had about 15-20% HP to work with at that point. Lotus Orb complete for the Darkseer. Didn't opt for the Shivas. I was curious if this was going to be the play. Lotus is obviously really good against Wyvern. If the Quinnipiac gets a Hex, pretty solid there too. And even just casually dispelling Amp, Damage Amp, or the Crippling Fear could be really good. Now, you really can't shut down the Darkseer. He's always going to get his spells off because he has two ways to purge himself. Either casting Lotus Orb on himself or the Guardian Greaves will both purge off the Nightstalker Silence. So, no matter how good this Nightstalker plays, the Darkseer will be able to get his spells off, and unless he dies in a Winter's Curse. So, Nightstalker, now we'll look at zoom out a little bit and look at Radiant Vision here. This is just what Radiant sees. They see an Observer Ward when they walk by it here. Thanks to the Gemetry Sight, they see all over the tree line, clear vision, map hacks, they may call it, but it's just really strong. This is the Aghanim Scepter effect for the Nightstalker, giving him full understanding, but actually missing out on that Observer Ward, unfortunately. So, Tier 2 Tower will fall to the hands of Wings. They're starting to really spread their wings and spread across the map very nicely, and they need to do this whenever they get the opportunity to do so, because otherwise, by default, the Nightstalker will control the map. The Aegis is going to be reclaimed in 2 minutes here. Oh, they thought it was real. Nice micromanagement there. And yeah, that illusion will fail to do anything. It was actually a Queen of Pain illusion there. She was just had a rune walking around. We're still going to see a Slaughter catch onto Beyond, but this is not the fight he really wants to take, even with James to back him up. We're going to see some split push play from Queen of Pain in the process, though. And she'll get a pretty massive creep wave on the Tier 3, most likely forcing some people to fall back. Super Splinter Blast. And we get some more Kale action. The AC will be picked up by the Wraith King. Aura is just really strong in this hero. He lives twice. He radiates, or the Radiance and the AC will stay in play for a very long time. And now you can look towards, Heart. I wouldn't go Refresher against the Mana Burn, but you can see Abyssal. MKB, if that's appropriate. That kind of stuff. Actually going to see Shadow caught out here. This could be a nice little pickup for them. They need to break the Blink Dagger early, though. And it's going to be a little bit difficult. Maybe Hitage over the tree line just drops an Arctic Burn on him. That would be strong. Splinter Blast as well. But he blinked forward, and now he's going to be caught out. It looked like he was going to try to TP, but he certainly won't get that opportunity. And obviously, once they make that first kill, the Juggernaut knows that he needs to rotate. Because either being picked off 4v1, or his allies are reinforcing the Wraith King, and he needs to get to the fight. So, for both reasons, Juggernaut needed to get away from bottom lane. And they'll just find an easy pick-off, as a matter of fact. Frozen Ammunition from the Ancient Apparition crushes the opposition. Frontline creeps. That's going to push out the top lane, so that's not easy to actually try to pressure the base. During this Wraith King pickoff. But nevertheless, FTD just get to move around with their Gem of True Sight, find all the wards, clear them all out, and have a jolly good time doing it. DD rune here on the Queen of Pain, but lacking in mana. It looks like she's going to actually be going for... Oh, nice little pickup there. The Aghanim Scepter of the Nightstalker doing work as they find out the Shadow Fiend, who went for the TP without his BKB. And that means the Void will send him to the Void, and they're going to push to this bottom tier too. Yeah, Queen of Pain... Could be Bloodstone, could be Octarine. Both are decent. I think Octarine Core is a little bit better here. You're going to be reducing the cooldown of your BKB. Obviously, the Sonic Wave will only be a 30-second cooldown. And I think one of the most underrated aspects is the fact that the Blink is going to be only like a 4-point-something cooldown. Really strong to have that much mobility available to you. So I like the Octarine Core. Also, the Bloodstone heal is often going to be negated by Ice Blast. So, Wings kind of pushed in right now and really need to start avoiding pickoffs and start moving as 5. I think they have a lot of potential if they all get their ultimates off in a 5v5, but right now FTD are just not letting them move like that. We're actually seeing the Juggernaut jump back here, just to obviously get the waves pushing. The Ancient Apparition has been doing one thing really well, and that's clearing out these creep waves. So that's allowing the Wings Gaming lineup to just kind of play their own game without having FTD set the pace, without them constantly knocking at their barracks. Another illusion rune means maybe another illusion bait. We'll see if maybe Wings are a little bit more cautious about the next play they make. This is pretty interesting. Silver Edge coming out on the Shadow Fiend here. Obviously, the breaking the passive of the Nightstalker, or sorry, the Juggernaut is the most important, because that crit is actually one of the best crit passives in the game. not as like satisfying in terms of burst, but very consistent in terms of damage output. So if you can break that, that'd be great. And of course, you also can then reduce the Juggernaut's damage output by 40%. Other than that, you know, taking away the Bash, taking away the Nightstalker passive, those are all well and good. But I would say overall, it's just for slot efficiency. The fact that now he can disassemble the Sanjin Yasha, upgrade to Silver Edge, and then keep on moving towards his next item. He really gets that quick burst early on in a fight, and if it can hit the Juggernaut, even better. Seeing another smoke play coming out from Wings, but I feel like this has been the biggest problem for them this game, is they have been lacking map control, and their smokes haven't been successful. I wouldn't say that they're bad movements. Overall, I think that they're moving at a decent time and in a decent way to try to find a pickoff. But the problem is that it just happens to be that FTD either know what's happening and move away, or they just get unlucky and they don't find their target. The reason this is really, really bad in this specific game is because now they're out of smoke of deceit. There is no smoke left for 6.5 minutes, and as far as I can tell, there's none on the courier, none in their inventories. So what that means is at nighttime, there is no way to approach the Night Stalker without him knowing. He pops his darkness here a little bit early before the nighttime, so he gets it back-to-back, and for the next 5-6 minutes, they just cannot fight. They cannot gank. They cannot kill. I'm actually going to see the Juggernaut, the Wraith King that gets a little bit of damage received as they combo up on him, but not even forcing the ultimate out there. But yeah, like I said, with this kind of vision, the Nightstalker sees everything coming. So you're able, without a smoke, you can't actually approach this guy and catch him off guard. And so for 6 or so minutes, Wings really don't have an offensive play to make. They're just waiting for FTD to make a mistake instead. And that's a long, long time when Roche is respawning soon. It's actually going to be within the next few moments here with only a 1-minute, 10-second respawn. It's not all bad for them, though. They do have the Ancient Apparition Aghanim Scepter effect. And for those that are just tuning in, I will repeat myself. This is not your stream lagging. This is not my broadcast lagging. It is literally just the connection from the United States to China that in this case is resulting in a packets being lost. And that's just because of the Chinese firewall. There are some measures that have been taken in the past that will allow you to like try to VPN over to the right side of the firewall, but so far nothing conclusive has been worked out that'll make it work 100% of the time. And Perfect World, as a result, has been creating some issues. Nice little observer ward here scouts out the potential movement of two members of Wings. They're not able to make a play happen there, and instead it looks like it's going to be a free Roshan for FTD, and it's not just Aegis, it's Aegis and Cheese. And we're going to be seeing a ton of momentum swinging forward for FTD as they look to essentially move in 7v5 with the extra health bars these items give them. The Aegis will go to the Queen of Pain. She also picks up a refresher. I can't believe... Yeah, I guess she just went for the soul booster for overall mana sustain, and now she can go for the refresher. She didn't finish the Octarine Core, and instead just goes for the big item, this game-winning item. Double BKB, double Sonic Wave, tons of potential with this, as she's able to just do so much pure damage, and really bring down Wings quickly, especially this Bane. Ancient Apparition will keep his distance. Darkseer and Wraith King very tanky, especially with the Guardian Greaves, but this Bane will die so quickly in every fight, and there's just nothing he can do. Cheese is actually going to go for the Slaughter for now. It looks like 6 Slotted Juggernaut doesn't want to drop a thing. He's actually going to be getting himself a Diffusal Blade level 2, and then he's going to go into the Moon Shard, or BOTs. Wraith King is going to slip away here, no problem. We're actually going to see them all move mid. Maybe look for an opportunity to break the Aegis early on. But they don't find it. And now Nightstalker is on the prowl, scouting and routing. So yeah, I would say one of the biggest issues here with Wings lineup is their catch potential is really limited. Actually, we're going to see the fight break out on Wraith King. Not the ideal target, but still they're going to go for it with the BKB popped on the Queen of Pain. Doing some good damage to the Wraith King, and they'll send out that first Sonic Wave. Jumping forward here, Wraith King still kicking. Again, this is not the hero you want to open on. With 2100 HP, the second life available, they force nothing out there. And that was really a good opportunity. Considering you have Aegis and Cheese, the ability to fight outside the Dire base is amazing. Like, you don't have to fight into a choke point where you get slaughtered by the vacuum wall, the ice blast. You get to kind of have this full concave, as they had here. They had everybody in a different position to move in, but they just couldn't get anything out of it because it was the Wraith King that is secure in his farm. Darkseer finally picking up a gem of True Sight. Usually you'll see a gem come out as soon as the Night Stalker picks up one, as you know, you need that any map advantage you can get, and there's a lot less risk in losing it when the enemy already has one. That being said, they have it now, and they're going to try to maintain control, but Slaughter's already looking to jump in, does get the crush here on AA, might not get the Ice Blast off, no, the Lotus Orb will give him some space. They'll back on the Slardar. We're actually going to see a lot of damage flying back the other way as they do echo the Splinter Blast, and the Ice Blast comes on through on top of the Juggernaut. Sonic Wave 1 coming through, actually that's the second one, and now it's going to be Queen of Pain nearly killing off two targets. Ancient Apparition will drop down, and no, he lives! The Queen of Pain has to keep blinking into the base to finish him off. Now we're going to see Nightstalker get caught inside a lot of spells here. Cold Embrace and Fiend's Grip being the two big ones. But still, the Shadow Fiend will fall in the end. They couldn't focus down the Nightstalker. And the Wraith King, one of the last men standing. We've got Bane and Darkseer behind him. They've got a wall as well, but I don't think FTD are done. They're going to look to get over this wall, get some Purge out. And although that will purge the Juggernaut too, they'll get the double crush, and they will be able to get both of these kills. Bane looks like the easier target first. Juggernaut absolutely destroys him there with that Omni Slash, and now they go for the base. They've taken all five. The Darkseer dying at the steps, and that might just be it. Right now, buyback status, as you can see, is Wraith King and Darkseer. The Lord of the Undead here, the Skeleton King, he can come back, but I don't know if that will do enough for them here. They've already lost so much. Another thing to mention is they don't have MKBs, so the Butterfly is just amazing on Juggernaut. He's no longer a hero they can prioritize. So that's a two-man buyback right now, Darkseer and Wraith King both buying back. And we're just going to see them move in and take the last Outer Tower instead. So they won't secure a Rax advantage. Heck, they won't even take a Tier 3. They've gotten two buybacks, which is the last two buybacks on the board. And then, of course, just put Wings in their place without losing the Cheese. They did lose the Aegis, but that's not that big of a deal. And Queen of Pain now has that Octarine. So 30-second cooldown Sonic Wave. 4.5 second blink. Really, really good stuff. High Ground Ward. Gonna be coming out here. I'm trying to think of what that will actually see, though. Especially Inflicted by Darkness, it doesn't see much. It'll see more when Darkness is not in play. It'll see actually on the lane. No much smoother arc than that. But when the Darkness is in play, it's absolutely worthless. Just sees exactly what you see there, right in the tree line. Nightstalker running around. He's level 19 thanks to this Hand of Midas. He's been doing some really good work with it. And might just go for like an Abyssal or something himself. Next, could go for Blink Dagger too. Once again, Blinks are really the bane of Wing's existence right now because they just can't get glued to a target. Darkseer Blink Vac is too slow to catch Juggernaut. Queen of Pain even in a lot of situations. It's just really tough. And now we'll just see them move all around as the lag intensifies. Ah, Perfect World. I hope nobody's playing a drinking game where I say Perfect World, because, jeez, they would be, at this point, on the verge of death, and I would feel very great remorse for that. I like this little movement here, so since it's daytime, they're not really ready to move out just yet. They're going to just kind of clump up, hide in the tree line, and see if there's any opportunities. But they're just going to show the Queen of Pain. She'll probably Sonic Wave this. No reason to really hold it unless you expect a fight, which very well might be coming in just a moment here. We're going to see Slaughter and Nightstalker jump forward, and they're going to just rout out the smoke. Now going to be Shadow Fiend caught out here. He does have a BKB. Will be forced, Glimmered, and Lotus Orb. It's going to be the Darkseer who eats the ultimate instead. He's Winter's Curse. He goes down without casting a spell, and now the Queen of Pain is going to be embraced by the cold, so she'll be fine. Slaughter will be destroyed on the Western Front as the Wraith King and Shadow Fiend collaborate, but that just opens up the Juggernaut to go for the big Omni Slash and bring one target down. With the Gem of True Sight Vision from Queen of Pain, they will bring down the Bane as well, And then they're going to go most likely for the Wraith King for the second time. Yeah, just cleaning him up, no problem at all. But the Juggernaut did take a few big hits here from the Shadow Fiend. That Silverhead still packs a really big wallop. And the Shadow Fiend stands his ground. But now they're going to be coming in again. They don't really have big disables. And Juggernaut blinks to the cliff. Oh no, Queen of Pain, gonna be caught inside the Requiem, gonna be wrecked! And that is gonna be a very unfortunate conclusion to the fight here for FTDB. Looks like that's gonna be the death of the Winter Wyvern as well, as much as he seeks to delay it. And, yeah, that's Shadow Fiend just absolutely tearing through them. Oh, you don't cold embrace right in front of a Shadow Fiend, that's not gonna help. That is not gonna help at all. Maybe he didn't think he had the Requiem back up, but he certainly did. And you see, he did, in conclusion, 8,000 damage. Wraith King also doing quite a bit there, getting a couple good crits there on the Slardar, but the Shadow Fiend is really the man in charge, and just got to do so much in that situation. Juggernaut does end up getting out, but jeez, that blink was not what he wanted. And even his Omni Slash was only, you can only argue it had limited effectiveness. All the Omni Slash did was one, like, 80-0 kill the Wraith King. And while that would be good against most heroes, Wraith King obviously has the ability to come back, and he gets to be a distraction, at least for that second life. The Wraith King, essentially, with two full health bars, is buying time for the Shadow Fiend to do his thing. And, time's still on his side, at least for the moment. He'll probably go for Daedalus next, I would imagine. Satanic. Oh, no, MKB. MKB is very important here. So he'll look for the Monkey King bar next. Wow, so actually a lot more action-packed than I expected to be. I felt like FTD had the lineup where they could just start choking out Wings, where they could start suppressing them with their vision advantage thanks to the Aghanim's Gem of the Night Stalker, and that Wings couldn't get a good initiation. And while that's true, the initiation started with a jump on the Shadow Fiend. Their response was great. They Force Staff him up, Glimmer, Lotus Orb, everything they need to keep him all up and kicking for the rest of the fight. And then when it all kind of devolves into chaos, the Shadow Fiend is just able to clean up. A really nice set of plays from him. And once again, I gotta apologize for the slideshow stuff. It's really out of my control, but I will see what I can do between game 1 and game 2. I feel the casting is decent in spite of it. It's tough. It really, you can't even imagine how hard it is to really understand everything that's being done just based on like the bare minimum animation. But I'll continue to do my best. And we do have a Wraith King looking for a BKB, but it looks like he won't be fighting as he gets crushed here on the front lines. They do have a lot of spells to throw his way, but Hitage in the backline, great! Ultimate here, the Darkseer gets caught once again by the Winter's Curse, and the Omni Slash brings him down. But they will kill off the Winter Wyvern in the process, and Wraith King will only die for the first time here. We're actually going to see the death of the Juggernaut. He'll have to buy back, and Queen of Pain is on the run here. The big Ice Blast coming out from the Ancient Aberration before he went down, and now they're going to look to clean up the Juggernaut too, but Shadow Fiend does have a Butterfly, not an MKB. Will she get the hits? And yes, he won't evade. He was fluttering! No, you can't flutter! Oh, Juggernaut, why? He tried to speed himself away with the active of the Butterfly, but that will, of course, remove the evasion for that six-second period. Don't flutter. Just don't. It's not the play when you're spinning away like that. And like if you're spinning and running, and you get like two lucky dodges with the evasion, and they don't have MKB or anything, then you could just blink out. You actually have the dagger for it. But in this case, he tries, he fails, and now it's actually gonna be a very interesting movement here on the Bane. I don't know if they've got this. They do have the Sonic Wave doing some good damage, but that actually weighs so much for FTD. It buys them a little bit of time, which is great. But will they really be able to follow it up with anything before the Winter's Curse it up? I don't think so. Sutter, no BKB. Now Blink crushes, but again, they're not accomplishing much but the delay play. Now Ice will be caught on the back line. At least they get something there. But Queen of Pain in a little bit of trouble. He eats a lot of damage from the Silver Edge before blinking out. The Ice Blast coming through. It should be the death of Slardar at the least. And we're actually going to see them get the second Sonic Wave off here for FTDB. So Bane is killed off in exchange for the Slardar. And I guess that's better than letting them just take the high ground, but not much better. Slardar is still being a very key aspect of your high ground defense. But the Wyvern lived, that's important. If the Wyvern dies there, you might just lose a full lane of Rex. Instead, he's up and kicking, looking for that Winter's Curse very shortly, has Blink and Force to set it up, but Juggernaut's still not up, and we are actually going to be seeing this fight break out in earnest. Our Winter's Curse will come out in the Shadow Vein, great target to focus down if they can finish him off, but he gets helped out, his Surge BKB, and he's just going to be fine. Didn't even need Guardian Grievous to top him off there, he is just dandy. And that Ice Blast will hit on the Fountain. It's going to be bringing down the Night Stalker and dropping the Queen of Pain low as well. She's got two Sonic Waves, though. She'll take a little bit to heal up in the Fountain, but if she can find an opportunity, she can absolutely wipe the floor with Wings. The problem is, they've taken their racks, they've gotten their spoils, and they are heading for home. Happy as can be. So yeah, the death of the Juggernaut all the way back here adds up very quickly to a full lane. Death of the Slaughter, the Night Stalker. It's brutal. Well, just look at that net worth graph, and the advantage they had was quite substantial. Closing in on 20k, probably closer to 18. But that's gone, and now, too, is that experience bleed. Solar Crest up for the Bane. Wraith King. Saving gold. Shadow Fiend, you got something. I know the Shadow Fiend is building up something juicy, and it is, in fact, going to be that Satanic. So, no MKB is a little bit awkward. But it seems like he wants to hit everybody but the Juggernaut here, so it goes for the Satanic. Now, there are a couple things that will mess with Satanic here. First and foremost is the Cold Embrace. You have Cold Embrace the target, obviously they're not getting hit by any damage from the SF, and therefore you're not lifestealing. The Manta Illusions for the Juggernaut. You hit Illusions, they're not going to lifesteal either. And finally, the Evasion from either Crippling Fear, if your BKB is down, or naturally from the Butterfly. So, gonna have to maybe get a little bit of reliable damage in there, but no matter what, Satanic buffs up his survivability quite a bit. He's definitely gonna be able to tank through the double Sonic Wave unless he gets hit by the Winter's Curse. Speaking of, we see Winter Wyvern blinking up, grabbing the smoke, and away they go. But Shadow Fiend is in a good position here on the high ground to just keep moving and maybe even force Wings and force FTD into a bad spot. But they're actually gonna be showing down on bottom, and now here comes the big flank. So the Aegis is on the Darkseer right now, but it's going to be Shadow Fiend that actually gets crushed out. He won't get the Satanic off in time. He's just going down. Hitage drops the Winter's Curse to secure it, and he doesn't have buyback. We're going to see a great wall vacuum come through, as well as a Fiend's Grip on the Night Stalker, but they just don't have damage now with the Shadow Fiend going down. Wraith King will do his best, but look at that Sonic Wave coming in for the Queen of Pain. Massive damage against Team Wings. It all started with the one pickoff that Wings couldn't afford. Oh no. We're gonna see Shadow. He got kited around a little bit here. Now they're gonna focus him down. Two lives in a row. He does have Blink, but that's no guarantee. He's gonna try to Blink away from this, and it's actually just coming off cooldown here. He will get crushed, he will get killed, and that's gonna be most likely another buyback from him forced. Darkseers, back in action. He had the Aegis, but everybody else, very, very unfortunately dead. Wraith King coming back, Ancient Apparition able to, but I don't know. BOT from the Juggernaut forces the early buyback, and A probably looking to do so as well. Yeah, like I said, the Aegis was on the Darkseer, the Cheese I think was on the Bane, and the end result is a very dead Shadow Fiend if you can't get that Satanic out. And that's the risk you run buying out for an item like that that needs you to be not disabled to work. Now we're gonna see Juggernaut just go in, cleaving hard on the creep wave, but that Wraith King is tanky enough that it's not going to be a good initiation. They did, however, force the BKB, and for whatever it's worth, the Lotus Orb. So FTD, feeling better about the state of the game, but I'm sure we're going to be seeing more Lincolns and Lotus play around this SF as a result of what we just saw. There was another interesting pickup here, and it is actually in the Juggernaut's hands. This guy is essentially 8-slotted now. This guy has BOT's level 2, and all the active items that he really wants. So what that means is, with the Moonshard buff, as well as the Refresher on the Courier, he's looking to just double up and double Omnislash. Catch somebody off guard with a play like that, and he could easily make a game-winning fight happen. That being said, it costs a lot of mana, guys. 350. Times 2, that's 700. That's already leaving you in your last 400 mana. So, obviously with Refresher Orb costing 375, and their Arcane Boots being okay, I guess. I mean, you got one Arcane on the Wyvern, no Guardian Greaves, so no, it's not as easy as you'd want it to be for the Juggernaut here. It's actually a really tough play to make. And yes, it is Kale still, guys. Lag, not necessarily on my end, but connecting to China, it's tough. So now FTD, just run into the enemy jungle. I don't think this ward will last very long. I don't even know why you place that kind of a ward against the Night Stalker. It just doesn't work. So that's gone. And a nice little ward here will stay up a little bit longer against Wings. They do have a gem in the Ancient Apparition, and he can just kind of Ice Vortex scout a lot of those. But in the meantime, FTD, it's kind of scary to even move out this far when you've got the entirety of FTD off the map, and they're just so fast. They can easily close in on you. They've got Blink Daggers on, what, 3 heroes? 4 staff on 2? Sprint, obviously. They have a lot of ways to close in on you, and the Night Stalker is the one that often leads the charge. Dire gets picked of their courier. Curious what that would have actually been. Oh, point booster for Wraith King. Is he going Ags? That'd be interesting. Buying out for Ags here. He really could give the Shadow Fiend a little bit of extra time to do his work. Yeah, he's going to sell the Blade Mail, pick up Aghanim Scepter. Awesome. So we're going to see Aghanim Scepter come into play here. Reincarnation, if a nearby allied hero is slain, they will be transformed into a Wraith and have their death delayed for 7 seconds. So they can do all the stuff they normally would be able to, but they will inevitably die 7 seconds later. So it just adds an extra 7 seconds of life. You can kind of call it like a shallow grave on a target that's like afflicted by Ice Blast. You know that they're going to die, but they get to do things a little bit longer, and that could be huge for a Shadow Fiend. Obviously giving him time to make sure that he always gets a Requiem off, and then often getting a lot of damage out in the process. So oftentimes you'll look for FTD to find a quick kill and then kite away. Find a quick kill and then kite away. They actually go in here and now kind of get caught into a fight they don't want. BKB comes out on James, and they really don't want to fight right into this Darkseer in this AoE clump, but a nice Sonic Wave flank, going to be bringing down Ice very quickly, and his Wraith will actually go for the Fiend's Grip by itself. The Winter's Curse, however, will disable him as the Shadow Fiend gets focused down. Pops to BKB. Where's the Satanic? He'll be right-clicking onto the Nightstalker and getting a couple good hits in here. So Bane does fall. Darkseer now as well with some delay, and the Ancient Apparition Ghost is walking about as well. But we're going to see some buybacks coming through. Will it be enough to actually bring this fight back, though? They're taking a lot of hits here, and the Shadow Fiend, I would say, is the big man in charge. Can't lifesteal off of the Cold Embrace. Instead, he's going to be taking a lot of hits, but he drops a big ultimate. The Requiem comes through. Sonic Wave will not be enough, and we're going to see Wings triumph. That Aghanim Scepter really seemed to be a big deal. I mean, yeah, the Fiend Script didn't go off because of the Winter's Curse secondary effect, but still, just having to fight against that created so much chaos, and in the end, the Shadow Fiend just narrowly survives through it all. Very, very close call. He could have easily been dropped down, but maybe he gets a lucky dodge or two, and then he just pops the BKB and obliterates. So now Wings are going to be forcing some buybacks here. 4 buybacks on the side of the Radiant. They've already got 3 heroes alive with 1 buyback already used. Shadow going to be frontlining. He's got that Reincarnate ready to roll. And we're going to see the buybacks right as soon as that Blink Crush comes through. But they're just going to force Lotus Surge away. Even the Piggy is going to be able to get some distance out here. But still the fast, fast lineup of FTD will claim at least 1 life. It's going to be the Ancient Apparition. But they want more. I think they do. Nope. Just those, that one. They'll keep on trying to pursue. Shadow looks like the easiest target, and he blinks out. Ugh, this lag is killing me. But Crush coming through. Very nice initiation from X, keeping them where they don't want to fight. And now it's going to have to be the Fiend's Grip on the backside here. Shadow Fiend taking a lot of damage. Can he get the Satanic off in time? It looks like he will, but oh, he's going to be a ghost. He's going to do some damage in the process, but he won't be able to Requiem with his last life. And he's going to explode there, as we now see Wraith King pushing forward onto the Juggernaut, who's running for his life. Bane goes down as well, gets a nice little Nightmare here onto the Queen of Pain, and the Wraith King will use that as time to kill off the Night Stalker. But other than that, it's a bit of a mess here. The Shadow Fiend's buying back the Winter Wyvern, hiding in the pit, and they think he actually went to the high ground. Instead, he TP'd here. Fight recap, going to sort things out for us a little bit here. 2,800 gold spent with the death of the Shadow Fiend there, And that's a huge buyback. That actually might be the one that FDD can use to push for the win. In the meantime, the Wraith King, of course, only dies once. He doesn't go down for the count. And we'll sit into a bit of a neutral period once again. 65 minutes into this crazy, crazy game. Oh boy. So. We've got, right now, Juggernaut benching his Diffusal Blade. Seems to realize that, well, first of all, he's got zero charges. He has not dispelled any Ghost Scepters, but maybe he's dispelled, like, Surge or something else, or just obviously slowed down a target. But end of the day, he benches the Diffusal Blade. He realizes the mana aspect isn't working against the Wraith King, and the Purge aspect is now used up entirely. He also has the Refresher Orb benched, as he used it with his second coming there. So, yeah. Double Omni Slash. Very powerful, but, you know, I think he used it one life and then the next is actually more what it came down to. But we're actually going to see a nice little jump here on Ancient Apparition. Could be a hero just pick off entirely. They're going to Lotus and force him out. He is barely alive still, and now we're going to be seeing a pretty heavy clash coming in as the Fiends are going to catch out the Juggernaut. This could be a huge pickoff. He's already bought back. This could be the game. Juggernaut going down for 110 seconds. Look at that buyback, guys. Queen of Pain will find the Ancient Apparition over here, but who gives a crap? That is not going to be what the game-winning pickoff. This creep wave pushing in and no Juggernaut to contest it, that's a game-winning situation for Wings. It has been 66 laggy, intense minutes, but we are here looking to see this game come to a close. Wings are marching up to the high ground, large and in charge, last tier 4 going down, no glyph available, and desperately FTD will look to hold on the Shadow Fiend here. He's going to take a lot of damage, but they'll just Lotus Orbit up, and even if he's Hex, he's going to be throwing Hexes back the other way. He'll survive long enough to pop the BKB, the Satanic, Lifesteal back up to 2500 HP, and see this thing through from start to finish. A great Guardian Greaves coming out from the Darkseer as well, but Lotus Orb doing a lot of work. The Agent going to be finished off here in just a moment, and that is GG for FTD. Wings Gaming will take the first game of this best of two series and bring us to the second game with a 1-0. In the grass. Telling an interesting story, but in the end, I feel like FTD had control of this game, and then it got out of their hands over time. Like, they were starting to suppress the Wings lineup really well, and they had in so many ways a strategic advantage where it was impossible for Wings to actually close in on them. They only had the Blink on the Wraith King and the Darkseer. They really couldn't catch targets that they wanted to. You'd either be spinned, BKB'd, four-staffed away. It just, you couldn't close. You couldn't find those openings. But time and time again, it just came down to FTD taking the initiation, finding their start of the fight by getting a good stun on somebody, and then, in spite of it, Wings turning it around, keeping this Shadow Fiend alive just long enough. And all in all, I gotta say that Wings played a hell of a recovery game, despite kind of a back-and-forth period. At the end, we had MKB on the SF, on the Juggernaut, and sure strike being a very key aspect to actually bringing their target down. But, man, that was a hell of a game. That was 67 minutes. That was game one. We're going to be jumping into Game 2 in just a few minutes here, but once again, I do want to apologize for the technical issues. Once again, it's about the connectivity from the United States to China behind that firewall, and I'll try to see if I can reset something to give us a lag-free Game 2 and the rest of the games here tonight, as we're pretty behind schedule due to the caster delay on the Chinese side and obviously the long, long game number one. But hype as can be, that was still a hell of a game, despite the slideshow, and I can't wait to see Game 2 in action, hopefully very seamlessly. Once again, thanks for tuning in. I myself am Blaze, casting on behalf of Beyond the Summit. See you guys in just a little bit for game number 2.